While considering the systematization of Ayurveda, which took place between 1st to the 6th centuries, we had mentioned the philosophical ideas in Ayurveda. That is what we will be considering in this lecture. And the contents of that will be as follows. How do they relate to the theme of Ayurveda, which is dealing with treating sick people? And the ideas themselves, man and cosmos, methods of accessing knowledge, because the doctors have to access knowledge about the patient, about illness, about medicinal plants and so on. How do they get this knowledge? Logical parameters of debate. How is it necessary for a doctor to know this? Body and its knower. Guide to living. Human destiny. And habitat. These are all ideas which have a philosophical basis, as we will discover as we go along. Now, one may very well ask, successful practice of medicine can be done without any knowledge of philosophy. Where is the need for this? This is a question which can legitimately arise. And Charaka, among the great three, showed that Ayurveda indeed is rooted in a philosophical soil. And if you want to have a qualitatively different type of Ayurvedic practice, you have to be sensitive to the philosophical base of Ayurveda. And a physician who aspires to be more than an average practitioner, he must imbibe the philosophical content or spirit of Ayurveda. And Charaka was the physician, philosopher, non-parai. Sushruta and Vagbhata, in their classics, they largely dispensed with the philosophical ideas of Charaka, because they were more and more moving towards the demands of the practicing Ayurvedic physician. Now, if you look at these, each one of these ideas, a little explanation. Man and cosmos essentially deals with the homology between substances comprising the human body and substances comprising the universe, its relevance to health, disease and treatment. The second, about accessing knowledge, traditional methods are perception, inference and words of the wise preceptors, or shabda as it is called. They are valid in Ayurveda, which prized reason, yukti. Yukti was always considered part of inference, but Charaka gave it almost a semi-independent status in claiming that Ayurveda in his time had become yukti vyapashraya. So he gave it a semi-independent status. Logical parameters of debate, important in a physician's training. Body and its knower, which has a metaphysical basis. Guide to living, what has philosophy got to do with it? The connection is essentially ethics, which cannot be separated from living. Human destiny, always important in the practice of medicine. And habitat, how unrighteous human conduct can lead to the ultimate cause of environmental devastation. Now, each of these topics, if you look at it, their connection with philosophy, one is it deals with cosmology, it deals with epistemology, deals with metaphysics, body and its knower, it is metaphysics. Epistemology, all this acquisition of knowledge is epistemology. Cosmology, evolution of the universe. Logic in the matter of debate, and bioethics when you are dealing with habitat. So therefore, each one of these topics have a direct connection with classical philosophical systems. Now, look at man and cosmos. We have referred to this earlier, and whatever exists in the cosmos, all the substances, they also exist in the human body. And whatever exists in the human body also exists in the universe. This is the Panchabhuta doctrine, which is very fundamental in Ayurveda. The number of constituents are countless, but at the gross level, these are the Panchabhutas. we have talked about it earlier, space and air and fire, and water, earth, all these. And the spirit or the supreme self. And all these panchabhutas, their derivatives in the human body have also been identified in these texts. For example, the heavy part of the body, the bones, for example, the derivative is originally derived from earth. Or similarly, agni, all the enzymes in the body, what we call, or metabolism, wherever heat is generated, that is all directly related to fire, agni. So like that, various body components, their origins in terms of panchabhutas, they have been very clearly, in fact, tables are available, what they considered were derived, what was derived from which bhuta. And the moment one discovers this identity, it is an epiphanic experience because it is a discovery. Nothing is away from us, nothing is strange. We are also part of this universe. That creates a new type of awareness. In other words, nobody is inimical. We are also part of that and they are part of us. Even philosophically, it is a new perception for an individual. The moment you realize that you are a tiny part of this universe. And going on this, how does it really concern a practicing physician? How does this cosmology or panchabhuta, how is it relevant for a physician practicing medicine? That connection comes at two levels. One is diseases which affect patients. They come from either excess or deficiency of doshas in the body, excess or deficiency of dhatus or body components in the body. So you have to bring it down to the normal range, because there is a normal range for these. They are all essential, including, as I mentioned in the morning, balas are also dhatus, as long as they are in that normal range. Vata, pitta, kapha, what we consider execrables. They are also part of the body, provided they are within this normal range. If they exceed that normal range, then they become doshas. So if it exceeds or it falls below that range, a physician, that is what we call disease or a disorder. And if a physician has to correct it, he has either to add or he has to subtract, whether it is a dhatu or a dosha. And this is done either through manipulation through drugs or manipulation through diet, pathya, that is how it is done. So if you want to, let us say, add to deficient a dhatu or a deficient dosha, you have to find a like substance. In Ayurveda, there is a concept, samanya and vishesha. The samanya and vishesha, actually, it is borrowed from our Vaisheshika system. And Vaisheshika is the mother of physical sciences in India. Kanada is the great name connected with Vaisheshika system, the atomic theory and so on. Now, this Vaisheshika system, they use samanya and vishesha in a very highly philosophical sense. In other words, a class which is united by one particular property, that is samanya. And a property which differentiates a class from this, that is vishesha. And vishesha, it goes on in this fashion, like vishesha is, that differentiation is made on the basis of some part which is consisting in that group, in that class. Suppose you keep on analyzing that and you will come to a stage when that part is not there, then what happens? So in Vaisheshika system, the Vishesha, what they say, even in the tiniest part, that Vishesha remains. So therefore, even at atomic level, there are differences. In other words, all the atoms are separate. In Vaisheshika system, unlike the modern atomic physics, atoms are also different, even that Vishesha persists at that level. So this is a highly philosophical concept in Vaisheshika. But Charaka, when he adopted this Samanya Vishesha into Ayurveda, he adopted the terms, but the meaning changed. Samanya is a class of substances sharing properties. Vishesha, in other words, Samanya substances which are united in properties, and if you put them together, they unite, they add to bulk. They grow. But if you have a vishesha, something opposed being united, then it diminishes. This is Samanya and Vishesha. What was abstract in Vaisheshika, terms were borrowed, but it became concrete in Ayurveda, because Ayurvedic physicians needed that. So therefore, if you are particular a dosha, a particular dhatu is in excess, you want to bring it down, you will use a substance similar to that if you want to add to the bulk. If you want to reduce it, you will use something with an opposing property. This is how that whole concept has been modified for application. So Panchabhuta becomes a tool in the hands of an Ayurvedic physician. And similarly, if there is a homology between substances in the body and substances in the universe, what happens in the universe will affect us. What happens in us in a very infinitesimal way might affect the universe. For example, if there is severe heat, heat wave, plants are affected, animals are affected, we are affected, everybody is affected, an external environmental change. So similarly, if there are environmental changes, suppose there is a place with very high levels of silica in the atmosphere, you to go to Rajasthan and see one place like that. It is an environmental change. People are doing industrial application, there is a lot of silica dust, whole lot of people will be affected. It is something entirely in the environment, man-made change in the environment, but it affects an external. So therefore, any changes in the environment, natural or man-made, that can affect the body. So therefore, the universe, what in one way for practice, it is important. And secondly, in the terms of changes taking place in the body, leading to diseases, there again, changes are extremely important. So Panchabhuta therefore becomes important in the practice of Ayurveda. Now then comes this question of cosmic evolution. An interested person will want to know what we call this universe with this enormous diversity, countless living beings, non-living systems. Universe is full of them, countless. How did all this evolve? Where did it come from? This is a question which had been asked in India for many, many centuries, even from Vedic times. But here, Charaka has a very important contribution in this area. And here it starts with the column avyakta, or undifferentiated existence. That is where, according to this Charaka's view of parinama or evolution, that is where it begins. In the beginning, avyakta, undifferentiated, indeterminate, a primordial existence. You cannot characterize it. There are latent forces in that. That is all we know. We don't know anything more about it. But at some point in time, which is not predictable, which is not controllable, there is some perturbation in that avyakta. Because of these forces, there is some imbalance, we don't really know what happens. But once that has happened, a series of changes, a cascade of changes, they are set into motion. And the first thing that happens, this mahat, the next stage, that is consciousness, is built into what was an undifferentiated existence. That is the next stage, which is called mahat or buddhi. And the next stage comes, follows. And that is ahankara, there is individuation, what was a collective existence, individuation develops. This is the next stage. And the next comes tanmatras. These are the forerunners of the five panchamahabhutas. These are not the mahabhut, the panchabhutas, but the forerunners of the panchabhuta, which lead to five bhutas. That's the next stage. And that leads to indriyas. The five indriyas, that is something concrete. And the indriyas, once they come, mind is part of it. It is not derived from the indriyas, but along a co-development relay. Because indriyas cannot independently function, mind has to be there. That is the indriyas and the mind. And the next stage, once the indriyas are there, there is something for the indriyas to do. They have got to have some object. If the eye, a sense organ, eye has to have something to see. That vision is there, smell is there, touch is there. That is what makes all these things accessible to us. So, indriyarthas is the next stage. And Indriyarthas really is the universe, because in universe is what our senses can perceive. We may use an instrument to see, use instrument to hear like a stethoscope, but still it is the ear which is sensing that. So therefore, Indriyarthas is what we call the physical universe. And what is beyond this, what is beyond the physical universe, suprasensory, that is not part of Ayurveda. In fact, Ayurveda very clearly says we do not deal with that. We only deal with this sensory world. So therefore, if this cycle here, starting with avyakta and coming up to Indriyartha, these are 24 stages, what are called chaturvimshati tattvas. They are called tattvas in the Charaka, it is Sankhya system of philosophy. That Charaka is one of the original contributors of Sankhya system. Apart from being a great physician, he was also a philosopher. Now, these 24 tattvas, there is a difference here. This evolution we are talking about, we come to Indriyarthas. You will notice Indriyarthas again, they go back to avyakta. So it is a cyclical change here. This is different from Darwinian evolution, with which we are very familiar. Darwinian evolution is open-ended. It keeps on evolving. There is no stop. Whereas here, it is different. Once it comes to Indriyarthas, at infinite time, it will dissolve into avyakta and the whole process will start again. This is Charaka's Chaturvimshati Tattvas, the original Sankhya system. In Ishwara Krishna Sankhya, which is the classical Sankhya written 100 or 200 years after Charaka, there are Panchavimshati, there are 25 tattvas. And he gave an independent, he added one more, that is Purusha. Because if you notice here, this 24, there is no place for an external agency. See, that is very important thing. There is no external agency here. In other words, if you want to pray, you are miserable. There is nobody to hear that. There is no place for any kind of intervention. This will go on. It is a harsh system, a merciless type of. There is no compassion, nobody to listen to us, to our prayers, nobody to wipe our tears. So it's a harsh system, but logically very acceptable, very appealing. So this is for the people, they crave for something. They crave for an Ishwara, for example. That is where, perhaps because of that, Ishwara Krishna has added independently Purusha, which is not there in this. Purusha is part of Prakriti in Charaka, but that has been given a separate status. So it became Panchavimshati. So that is the difference here. Now, the original Sankhya is credited with Charaka, and the classical Sankhya of Ishwara Krishna is 25, and that came later. So this is therefore not directly related to the practice of medicine, but it is important in the sense, you may remember or you may have heard, there is an old Indian story about three stonemasons. Three people were carving stone. And the first man was asked, what are you doing here? I am carving the stone. I am paid 100 rupees a day. The second man was asked, he said, I am carving a stone. There is a temple being built here. I am paid 100 rupees. Third man was asked. He said, they are building a Shiva temple here. And I am carving that Nandi. And Nandi is Shiva's carrier. He has to occupy a lower level. He's the master is sitting at a higher level. So I am carving his eyes now. It has to be focused in an upward direction. That's what I am doing. I am paid 100 rupees. Now if you look at these three people, they are doing the same job essentially. But the third man, he gets far more out of his work than this 100 rupees. And also the quality of his work will be different. If you go to great temples, you may see these Deepayakshis standing holding a lamp. I'm sure in Tamil Nadu also you have. You may see 100 of them standing, but they all look alike. But once an art critic told me, you think they're all alike, but they're not. If you go and look, an art critic can make out much easier than us, because we are not art critics. If you look at them, superficially they look alike, but they're not alike. When you look, you will find suddenly one Yakshi will be jumping out and coming towards you. Special, different. That's because it is carved by a man who put a bit of his own soul into it. That will look different. Now, there is something in what he said. So, therefore, here the physician who is just ordinary treatment, you know pathology, you know medicine, you treat. But an Ayurvedic physician who knows this, the basis of knowledge, the basis of evolution, he is a very different kind of physician. He is like a charaka. And a patient going to him, the very sight of him might partly relieve his illness. So that is the difference essentially. It is not for the, in fact, Charaka alludes to this in the beginning of his Samhita. There is a classification of decoctions, 50 different, there is a classification, 50 groups. At the end of it, then it is good for fever, for diarrhea, for so many things. At the end of it, he says, Mandanam Vyavaharaya, Buddhanam Buddhivarthaye. This table I have given is good for the dim-witted ordinary physician, Mandanam Vyavaharaya. But he doesn't stop there. Buddhanam Buddhivarthaye, for the wise, this is to extend the domain of knowledge. You can interpret it in any way you like. You may want to create new formulations, find new medicinal plants, which we have not even done today. Because how difficult is it to find a wild plant, whether it has medicinal value? How do you do that? They had done it, 1900 plants he had done. We haven't done anything since. So you could do that. Or you could find out how they work. That also we have not done. So extending the domain of knowledge is open to us. But how few of us actually do it? So therefore, a physician who reflects on all these, he becomes a physician extraordinary. That is what is important here. Then we come to extending the, then we come to extending knowledge. This is epistemology, very much a part of philosophy. And there are the classical, our epistemology, authority, aptopadesha, that is a valid form. Many Western logicians will not accept it. That is, you don't take what somebody says an authority, they don't accept it. But in India, in our systems, that is accepted. And Ayurveda especially, it is important. But this apta, who is the apta? Whose word are you going to take as an authority? And you look at the definition. You can easily say wise savant, but he has the power of knowledge and authority, who is rich in experience, who is incapable of lying, whose character is spotless. He is a source of knowledge. A student should accept his authority. And why? Because a physician, from his experience of so many years of treating, if he says this particular sign is dangerous, you should do like this, or you should not give this medicine at this particular stage, that sort of thing you cannot learn from textbooks. It learns from experience. And if you insist that all these, you will also do experiments and discover, that means you will be doing it at the cost of many patients. So therefore, it is, we are obliged to listen to experience. So that is a valid form of knowledge, aptopadesha. And the second is perception. This has been always, even Western countries, everybody accepts perception. Even the lokayatikas, the materialists of India, they only accepted this, no other form of knowledge. What we can see, what we can experience, that alone is the source of knowledge. But that's a very complex process, because it involves instruments of perception and a certain process and a certain agent which has to become aware of it. All these are involved in perception. Now, if you look at the words of aptopadesha again, to repeat that, this is as good as scriptural authority, valid. And then we come to perception. Five sense organs, jnanendriyas. Objects of senses which we have already seen, indriyarthas, sound, touch, vision, smell, taste, these are all our sense organs who can, we can pick up these, mind, intellect and the knower. These are the instruments. If anyone is lacking, then there can be no perception. Now, if you look at that, each one of these we can consider. The senses like smell, or vision, they pick up a particular object. Now that information which is picked up by the sense organ, it cannot pick it up unless mind is involved. For example, I come here, the clock ticking, I can hear that. But once my mind changes, I am listening to someone, I am doing something else, I no longer hear that. Clock is still ticking. The sound waves are impinging on my eardrum, but I am no longer aware of it because my mind has changed somewhere else. So therefore, in this knowledge process where all these instruments interact, that is what we have to, the real philosophical basis of perception, the sense organ, the sense object and the mind, a certain complex data is created, maybe auditory, maybe visual, maybe related to taste, but that all these three agents work together to produce a particular product, a knowledge product. Now then the next stage is that knowledge product doesn't stop with the mind, it goes to the buddhi, that is the next stage, which is another part of the instrument. And this buddhi, if you can well imagine a product which is related to taste, a knowledge product related to vision, all these are entirely different. But when they come to buddhi, the analogy used is, suppose the fingers are playing on a multi-stringed instrument. Number of strings are there and your fingers are moving on them, it creates all kinds of tunes, variegated tunes. That is the analogy they use. So here, this sense organ, sense object, mind product, that if you can imagine is a finger, and there is a multi-stringed instrument which is the buddhi. When it comes and plucks, and it is an intelligent plucking, because obviously we don't hear this camera, we see it. It is highly specific. Music I hear, I don't see it. So therefore, each of these products, when they come to this multi-string instrument of buddhi, then all these enormous perceptions arise. But then it doesn't stop there. Once this is happening, somebody has to know this. That is knower or self. That is the next stage, Purusha. This is not the Purusha, the supreme self. No, we are not talking about that. There is something in individual self, Jivatma. When in our Indian philosophical systems, they believe, for example, when a man dies, there is a Sushma Sharira which leaves that body and goes to another person. The whole reincarnation is based on that. Now, that is Jivatma. That Jivatma is inherent, and that Jivatma is active only when it is in, comes in contact with this particular complex, that is sense organ, sense object, mind, buddhi. That product, self is the one which becomes aware of it. Now it is important because mind is, all these are integral. If the instrument is defective, there is no knowledge. All these have to be there. And if self is not there, then this is inactive, this mind complex. Mind itself is inactive if self doesn't come there. And self detached from these is alone, it cannot be aware of anything. It can become aware of it only when this product comes. So there is a mutuality in the relationship. So therefore, this complex process, the knower, is also part of this. Very different from, this is a personal self, individual, very different from the supreme self. Then we come to inference, which is very important because a physician, this is what physicians in those days, there were no laboratory reports, they had to use inference very, very much. Observation, past, present, observations made by others, you infer a lot of things from this. And this inference, there are three types of inference. It can be consequent and precedent, what came first, what came later. That, like for example, consequent and precedent. If you take rain and rain clouds are the precedent, rain is the consequent. Now if you take precedent and consequent again, sexual intercourse and pregnancy. Pregnancy is consequent and sexual intercourse is precedent. And there is a third type, a complementary pair. They always go together, fire and smoke. So if you see fire, then you can there must have been smoke here, or smoke, there is fire. That is because of complementarity. So there are three types of inference. All these are used in medicine. When you see a person having a rigor, then you know he is going to have fever. That is a, you know immediately, it is a precedent. Like malarial patient, he is having rigor, you know very well he is going to have fever. So like there are so many which we use all the time in the diagnostic process. And then we come to logical parameters of debate. Why should this be important? Charaka gives a whole section dealing with this. And the reason is, it is not meant for all physicians. Physicians who have a particular view, a doctrine, they want to present it before an audience. They want them to accept it. If you want to gain, today is like presenting a paper. You want to go for an international conference, you have something new to report. Only those people need this. All the people are not interested in presenting papers or getting global recognition. If you want to do that, then you have to know this. And the logical parameters of debate, what are the rules of debate, how you should speak in an audience, how you should treat with the umpire, all those. You have to be aware of these so that the scholar sitting in the assembly will listen to you. So therefore, Charaka devotes a whole lot of debate on this subject, and he deals with friendly assembly. You may go to an assembly where you know most of the people, maybe your own alma mater. People are friendly, respectful, and you have one way of dealing with them. You can take a lot of things for granted there. Many of them may be good, personally known to you. It is one way to deal with that audience when you present. But you may go to a hostile audience, a foreign audience, for example, highly critical of what is being done in India. When you go there, your attitude has to be different. It can't be the same. And you may go to a hostile audience where they will be highly critical of you. And then Charaka, in this particular different types of assemblies, how you should strategize yourself. All that is described here. And in fact, it goes into such details. You should find out the opponent, your adversary, his weaknesses. He may not be very good in articulating. He may be very deficient in his knowledge of history. He may be very deficient in something else. He will be a nervous person. All these you should find out. This is what he says. And you should attack him on that, his areas of weakness. If he is deficient, you make a big quotation from something. And he will immediately, he will be off balance. And you should take advantage of that. So like that, there are a whole lot of practical instructions how to win a debate. And sometimes even you may think that some of these are not even ethical. So that to win the debate at any cost, sometimes it goes to that extent. But then all this is when you tend to doubt, is it correct to do that? When you begin to think like that, there is a relief in the sense at the end of it, this chapter, he says, the debate among physicians should be confined to topics in Ayurveda. Then he says, not a word should be spoken which is not well thought out, or which is out of place, or which is confused, or lacking in scriptural authority. Whatever is said should be backed by reason, because debates based on reason are free from ill feeling. That is how he concludes. So that is a big relief after reading all this. And body and its knower, it is all metaphysics. Some of this we have already covered in that section dealing with acquisition of knowledge. Mind, self and body, Charaka regarded as the tripod which supports an individual's existence. And this interrelationship can be viewed differently. Mind, except when the mind is active, this we have already touched upon earlier in perception. Sense data are not registered by the individual, because that also we have seen, if the mind is not present there, then the sense data doesn't register. That is already known. That is, the mind is the controller of the sense organs, or the master of the orchestra, which analyzes and conveys the data to the intellect or buddhi. and devoid of consciousness of its own. It is self which gives consciousness to it. And sense organs, five sense organs, this essentially it is, slight differences are there, but the epistemology, what we said, is virtually being repeated here. There are five respective sense objects, sound, touch, etc. There are five motor organs also to execute. And the intellect, we have at the frontiers of the mind, intellect comes, buddhi, and self, cause of the living individual, the ultimate basis of existence, which enables us to appreciation of light and darkness, truth and untruth, things like that. All this comes from self. Now the body and its knower, actually that discussion comes because often we say it is my hand, my eyes. All that we talk about, who is this I? When you say it is my heart, who is that I, the owner of all this? That is the context in which this is being presented. That body and its knower. Body doesn't know that, it's not visible. But that self who owns all this, he is aware, but the body itself is not aware. That is how it comes, Kshetra and Kshetrajna. Kshetrajna is the knower, Kshetra is the body. Then we come to guide to living. A lot of it, there is no philosophy in it, but there are ethical dimensions, and ethics is a very important part of philosophy. Human body is engineered to maintain good health. So, ill health or disease is really an aberration. It is an accident. Often we are falling into a pit we have ourselves dug. That is what we call a disease. And all that medicine does, as Vagbhata says, is to give a helping hand to get him out of this pit. That is all medicine does. He may himself climb out of it, but a physician can give a helping hand. That's all it does. And lifestyle holds the key to wellness. Ayurveda prescribed detailed guidelines on conduct in the different segments of an individual's life, practically all segments of an individual's life, personal, professional, spiritual, etc. And personal conduct, look at the details, guidelines. Some of these will come again and again because Ayurveda, the code of living is a very, very live subject. Everywhere you will find it impinging on the discussions. Here is brushing teeth, bath, apparel, sporting ornaments, haircut, paring nails, conversational style. All these are covered, how you should conduct yourself. A whole section was devoted to food, including the detailed classification of food. We will be having a separate discussion on that. Incompatibilities in food items, what to avoid, dining etiquette, how to eat, what to eat, how much to eat, all these are discussed. And food poisoning is discussed. Then consuming food was looked upon not as meeting a biological need, it is much more than that. You have to enjoy that food. There is also a spiritual dimension here, because it is likened, like you pour libations into the sacrificial fire. And imagine that the food that you are eating is also a sacrificial fire. There is a fire in the stomach. So you find a parallel being drawn even at the spiritual level. So it was not just meeting hungry, a biological urge, it is something more than that. There is an aesthetic element, there is a spiritual element. Personal conduct continues here in different seasons, because these classics in Ayurveda, they were written in North India. Weather extremes, in summer it can be extremely hot, in winter it can be extremely cold. So the code of conduct has to change radically to suit the environment. So Ritu Charya was a very important subject. And here you will find very detailed description on all these, the code of conduct mentioned earlier. In all respects you have to change, about your diet, about your sleep, all those have to change. So the general conduct was completely modified to suit the environment, the ritus of that. We will be discussing this also. And there is an interesting side in this, that is when you talk of ritu, think of cold and heat. But according to Ayurveda, we will have a discussion on this later. When these weather changes take place, especially the summer, or winter. In summer, all the trees, they shed their leaves, they become lean. Water is being drawn away from the earth, including the human body. Earth becomes dry, plants become dry. So when this drying, desiccation goes on all over, Ayurveda believe, just like there is water, a solution of salt solution, if the water is evaporating, it becomes more and more concentrated. So similarly in the body, they believed, when this desiccation goes on in a, let's say Grishma or summer, then body chemistry changes. So when they put it, the taste changes. In summer and winter, the two halves of the year, it was, even though there are six seasons in Ayurveda, for Ritucharya they were divided into two, 6 months each. And that hot half, the body chemistry is different because tastes are different. Taste is a shorthand for chemistry. So therefore, you have to have your diet, your food, all this will have to adapt to that particular chemical environment in the body. So Ritucharya is not only the simple common sense in Ayurveda, there is also a particular scientific basis for this change in conduct. And then life is, there is a lot of life beyond bread, and they talk about perennial subjects, truthfulness, forgiveness, compassion, equanimity. Some of these we talked about it this morning. Dedicated work with indifference to results. And again, to see oneself in all the living beings, all the living beings in us, they are all our kin. That feeling repeatedly, a number of times Ayurveda talks about all these three acharyas. Even the ants, they are all our brothers. Now with the discovery that in terms of even the humble earthworm, 30% of the DNA they share with us. So it has a particular relevance today when they say all these are our brothers and sisters. That is very true. So this is something Ayurveda repeatedly stresses, the brotherhood or sisterhood of all that exists, living beings. Another aspect is liberality, very liberal way of thinking. There is no rigidity. For example, in the only place you shall do this is when the students, when they are taking an oath, when they are being accepted for training by an acharya, there is a certain ceremony with fire as the witness, and the teacher will give commands, and the student has to say, yes, I do, in the presence of a big assembly. That was the initiation ceremony. Now there, they are all orders. You shall tell the truth. You shall do this, and he will say yes. But when the physicians, when they write their prescriptions everywhere, you will see, you may do this, you may do that. So in Sanskrit, that verbal form itself, ling and lot, there is a difference here. So you will find that liberality, you may try this, you may do this. You will never find a prescription, you shall give it. You will never see this. So that liberality, a willingness to accept, that there may be other ways equally effective of treating. That is a very important thing. And Charaka, in fact, a code of conduct which he describes in very great detail, he concludes it by saying, if someone has found good result by following another code, that is acceptable too. Because somebody living in another country, used to a different lifestyle, different type of food, different way of clothing, and he finds himself in good health, there is no reason for you to impose your code on him. That is acceptable too. So you will find that liberal attitude. And professional conduct, Ayurveda, this is about physicians. He insisted on higher standards from physicians, and this is fully reflected in the oath which I mentioned. We will be talking about it when we deal with training. And the physician must have mastery of ancient text, theoretical knowledge. He must have practical skill, clinical experience, access to necessary equipment, noble character, intelligence, sharp memory, and above all, friendship and goodwill to treat all living beings as his siblings and kin. Again, you come to this. And no wonder the Vagpada, in his conclusion of Ashtanga Hridaya, there is a famous Prasajam Sadhu Vrittanam, that shloka, glory to the physicians of noble conduct. and keen understanding of medical texts. Glory to the physicians whose practical experience is profound. Glory to the physicians who regard all living beings as their own children and friends. So these are the qualities prized in physicians. Outlook on life. And here the Indian stereotype, they denigrate life. I have already shown some slides. Human body is all very filthy, it's full of this, full of pus, full of urine, this kind of constant denigration of the human body. Vedantists do that, Buddhists do that, create a revulsion to life. This is totally absent in Ayurveda. The attitude is a cheerful attitude, confident attitude, eagerly welcoming long life, good health, and all the bounty of nature. And Charaka states this explicitly at the beginning of this classic. In fact, he says, what are the basic urges of life? One is pranayishana. We want to live long, healthy. That's the first thing we want. Because if there is no life, everything is lost. Second, vittayishana, we need money. Because there is nothing more miserable than living a long life in poverty. So, and you must work as a farmer. You must take up a job, king's job, an office, something you must do. And third, he says, paralokaishana, a better afterlife. And there he adds, there is some doubt about this. And he gives a long, convoluted argument to convince himself and convince us that there is indeed some validity in that. But that is not what his primary emphasis is this. So therefore, there is no element of Puritanism in Ayurvedic classics. Food, vegetarian, non-vegetarian, no bar on enjoying wine, no obligation on performing rituals. But all this freedom had to be exercised within the limits of dharma. That is, what is good for you should be good for others also. It should not be making other people worse. That is not dharma. So within that limitation, you should enjoy life. And this is Vagbhada, it's the cover of my book, specially drawn by a very well-known artist in Kerala, Nambudri. Because Vagbhada, there is a legend that he was originally from Sindh. It is only a legend, there is no proof. But it is a fact that Vagbhada's Ashtang Hridaya is most popular in Kerala. Out of the commentaries, I think there are 18 or 20 commentaries, 12 of them were written in Kerala. And almost everybody there knows something about Ashtanga there, because it's a great poetry. But the story is that he was actually a Brahmin in Sindh. In those days, all the great physicians were Buddhists. So he was so keen to learn medicine, he went to a Buddhist teacher pretending to be a Buddhist. So he studied under him for several years. And at some stage, he thought the teacher had realized that this man was not a Buddhist. So before the teacher could pronounce a curse on him, he absconded from there. When he came back to his Brahmin colony, they would have nothing to do with him. They said, no, 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 you're an outcast. You left us, you went to the Buddhist, don't come here. But he was a great physician. He was so upset by all this, he left Sindh. And he traveled all the way along the west coast. He came to Karnataka and finally he reached Kerala. I'm talking about the 6th century. And Kerala was not today's Kerala. And when he came, these Nambudris from the north were coming in waves, small, small groups, by the same route. And they were all setting up colonies. They would not go to the mountains, Western Ghats, too frightening. They wouldn't like to go to the ocean, which they were not used to that. So there was a middle strip of Kerala where people tended to settle down. So near Trichur area, it is believed there were Nambudri colonies. And Vagbhada arrived there, he found these very intelligent young people knowing Sanskrit. And they found an extraordinary teacher, a great scholar, poet, and he had this manuscript with him, Ashtanga Hridaya. Extraordinary combination of poetry and medicine. It was an instinctive attraction in both directions. This is the belief. So he settled down and he set up these Ashtavaidyas. That is the belief. Anyway, So this is that Vagpada with his students. Now, human destiny, very interesting subject. Now, doctors, vaidyas, physicians, they are always concerned with this, because we are dealing with illness and you don't know what will happen. Patients, relations want to know what will happen. That is their question. They are not interested in the diagnosis. They want to know what will happen to me. So therefore, destiny is pressing on us. It is a compulsive element in medicine. And disease may be curable. Charaka says in the beginning itself, you must know whether the disease is curable, curable with difficulty or incurable before you start treating. He says that. And they should also know if there is a danger sign, mortality, they must be able to recognize it. And Charaka says, patient may die, he himself says that. There is a quartet in the practice of medicine. That is a physician, the patient, an attendant, and the medications. These are the four elements. And each one of these has four qualities. So if all these qualities, 16 qualities are present, then the treatment will succeed. This is the dictum. But Charaka himself says, when all these are excellent, quartet is first class, but still the patient may not survive. That we see. Naturally, the question of destiny becomes a very important one for a physician. And traditional views in India, one was nothing can be done. You cannot change destiny. It is fixed. No use trying to do anything. That is a very popularly held view even today. But what is not known, in India there was a similarly equally strong view called Paurusheya, which you see in Yoga Vasishta, which says exact opposite. Devam Nihatya. Why don't you defy destiny? Guru Paurusham Atmashaktya. Exert your will. So that view is also there. Both these views are there. And Vagpada, Ayurveda, tends towards that direction. Vagpada actually says, take note, human effort can indeed overcome fate. It's a very hopeful thing for a doctor, physician to feel. And several centuries earlier, Charaka had prepared the ground for this discussion. Now, here Charaka says, he takes a middle position, which he was always very fond of taking. For acts of enormous sinfulness, children being raped and killed and so on, acts of enormous cruelty. Now that sort of thing, karma will take its effect. Nothing can change that. But for most of us ordinary people, our doings have very little moral content like this. For example, we know that if we keep on smoking, we will get lung cancer or maybe coronary artery. There is no moral content in that, ethical issues. It is something entirely in our, we can control it and we can prevent. You cannot say that is predetermined. So therefore, a lot of things that they are within our control. That is what Charaka says. At one extreme, you cannot prevent, that will act. But a whole lot of things within our control, we can change our destiny. Then he says, how free are human beings to do that, to desist from smoking? Do we have the freedom to do it? That question he raises. So therefore, the good conduct, in the traditional view, all the suffering of humanity is because of false knowledge. Our Vedanta or our six systems of Indian philosophy, they all say human being suffers because of their false knowledge. False knowledge means what? Temporary, you are mistaking for permanent. Untrue, you are mistaking for true, like that. These are essentially metaphysical concepts, philosophical concepts. But Charaka says these are all, we suffer because, not because of false knowledge. That is the important thing. It is because of erroneous understanding and our erroneous judgment. These are within our means, whether it is desisting from smoking, all kinds of things where we can desist, it is within our control. That erroneous judgment, erroneous activity. Those are practical things, not metaphysical statements. So according to him, he gives a hopeful view, how we can order our conduct in such a way that we can eliminate suffering. And you cannot say that was also predetermined. This is what Charaka says. If you say everything is predetermined, he says, where is the need to have any physicians at all? where is the need for prayer? Where is the need for anything? Because everything is predetermined. So he ridicules that. It's a hopeful message. And habitat. Charakas has a section called Janapadodhvamsana. He was very conscious of the generosity of nature, all that we have, nature's bounty. And this all gets destroyed if there is an epidemic. People die, vata, pitta, kapha, everything becomes irrelevant. The whole population, fauna and flora, they are all destroyed, regardless of anything. Now, these things happen because of essentially unrighteous conduct. Unrighteous conduct on the part of people, on the part of the rulers, and he gives all these examples. A ruler who is plundering people, unjust, corruption everywhere, nobody to look after the administration, there is no governance. So there is complete anarchy, everyone for himself. When we come to that, righteousness, gods run away from that place. Now that is where famine comes, shortages come, epidemics come. Lots of people suffer from that. So that whole habitat is destroyed. Essentially, you may, of course, you should try to prevent it by diet and medicines and all that. But for this type of destruction, that alone will not do. The fundamental answer is unrighteous conduct must change, whether it is rulers or whether it is ruled. So the habitat, he was very much aware that righteous living, what we call sustainable living today, or righteous conduct, all those environmental ethics that we talk about. Essentially, it is that. That is, you cannot imagine that all this is for myself. All this is for humanity. There is no place for birds, no place for animals. It is all for us. And it is all for the present generation. We don't worry about the grandchildren who will come. So you have to remember, when you, the moment you are aware of this, you are conscious of bioethics. It is not for myself. It's not for human beings alone. It is for everybody, for the plants, for animals, for the next generations. Now that awareness, if you have, that is righteous living. Now Charaka says that is what he says about habitat, which is environmental ethics, a very profound and very much alive subject today, which has covered practically every aspect of philosophy and its relevance to the practice of Ayurveda.